called Sunshine. She was built in 1948 on the Fraser River in Vancouver. And she's my baby. We've already come 2,500 miles together, just her and me, and the cat Moto. Foot long, but only 6 foot wide. She's kind of tender, but I love her anyway. I'm planning now to sail 1,000 miles south to Fanning Island. It's a pretty small spot, only 9 miles across. It's not too bad to get there using the Northeast trades, but coming back could be something else. I had to hold out in Honolulu and repainted. Here's Frank. He was my painter. He's also a single-hander telling his story to a magazine there. I always get a little choked up when she slides down the rails back into the water. It seems kind of silly, but I always wonder whether she's going to float again. The guy operating the winch here is Pete the Pirate. He owns the yard and charges just about anything the traffic will bear. Look at that, she does float. Isn't she beautiful? They won't let me touch her until she's floating. Something to do with insurance. So I'm just standing here with a camera, getting excited again. With no moorage now, I have to work quickly and get on my way. And so, on kind of a windless morning, I'm pulling out of the marina, leaving Honolulu southbound for the Line Islands. You can probably see the youngest member of this team. That's Moto. He's been with me since just a tiny kitten in the Vancouver shipyard. My engine is a two-stroke universal built in about 1935, even older than the boat. There's the yacht club behind me. I'm not a member, but they were really hospitable and gave me 2 weeks free moorage. It's coming up to Hawaii's winter now, so there's not much wind today. It's the Kona season, which means variable, basically, and this is fairly calm. But in the evening, the offshore breeze is just enough to carry me away from the land. I'm starting to calm down now. Honolulu makes me so hyper, and I've spent the last 2 days shopping at the Ala Moana Shopping Center. I can't stand it and just go down below and crash. I woke up to a totally calm day and was amazed to find my log reading 50 miles. It appeared that Sunshine had made the first 50 due south, and I had slept through the whole thing. Now there was scarcely a ripple on the water other than that left by the huge mahi-mahi meandering around the stern. Moto and I settled down to relax. He to watch these giant monsters and I to read a couple of books. We needed the break. The last few days have been quite hectic, and the stores aboard now weigh us down so low that I'm certainly not interested in fishing for these great beasts. Some of my friends had warned me against heading offshore during the Kona season, and I idly speculated if this calm was foretelling something worse. We sat there in awe for a day and a half, as rather curiously did a giant freighter on the far horizon. Sooner or later, the wind had to pick up, and later in the day, I got a slight northerly and rigged up this rather weird contrivance to steer the boat. One thing about offshore sailing I've found is that you don't want to have to steer yourself. It's just too much of a chore. But I don't have any of those fancy things like wind vanes or autopilots. The fanciest steering device I've got is surgical tubing. It sounds rather strange, but it's elastic, and with that to balance the pull of the sails, I can usually work something out. You may be wondering who took these pictures. Well, I had a clamp for the camera and put it on the aft pulpit, and sometimes I just set her running. I could have told you Moto took them, I suppose. It turned out to be really pleasant weather for the first 3 or 4 days. The trade winds gradually began to return, and the old familiar sights and sounds of the ocean came back. The booby birds gliding and soaring, attempting to land on the mast. And with the wind moving now into the northeast, we started reaching under the best sail combination, which is jib, staysail, and single-reefed mainsail. And so, by the third night out, I'm moving along pretty well and quite happy with my progress. This was the way navigation was done. That's a plastic sextant I'm holding, about $40 worth. It's pretty good for day shots, but not too good if you're trying to sight on the stars or the planets at night. One of the main problems with Sunshine is she's so small with so little storage space that storing all the charts and navigation books necessary was tough, and I had to build storage for just about everything that I took along. Now this may be the last time I try getting shots of myself. This is supposed to be a fairly easy sail change of the staysail Genoa to the storm staysail. And for you sailors out there, you'll see that the first thing to happen is a jibe, which is not the best thing to be going on in an uncontrolled fashion like this. So I hang on as best I can, reset everything, and dash back up the front. The problem with my self-steering system is it depends very much on the balance of the sails. So every time a sail change has to be made, the balance is necessarily disturbed, with, of course, some rather interesting results. The first time the boat heads off the wind and jibes, so what do you think? Second time it heads up into the wind. You wouldn't believe it, but I had this whole thing rehearsed. You see, the film cassette is only 3.5 minutes long, and that's not a very long time to change a sail. I'm starting to get mad here now, I think. It really shouldn't have been that tough, as I have 2 forestays, and so had the storm sail already hanked on and ready to go up. But, as you sailors know, nothing ever works the way it's supposed to. Oh boy, look at that foul up. Of course, it's a good idea to wear a lifeline when you're doing things like this, but one of the problems with that is that it gets caught in just about every conceivable spot. When I finally got that sail up, she started flogging, which told me right away that the sheet had come off. Don't ask me how, but I do know that a flogging clue can be lethal when the wind is blowing. Fortunately, it wasn't often that sail changes of this sort were necessary, as on the average day, the wind was blowing more like this, around 25 to 30 knots, and I had just the fully reefed main and staysail continuously set. Those gentle trades we all hear about didn't seem too gentle during these few days. In fact, heavy cross seas, presumably coming up from the approaching southeast trades, forced me to heave to for about 12 hours as I just couldn't stand the motion. Many of the waves, I'd estimate, about 15 foot from trough to crest. If you look carefully, you can see some flying fish not bothered a bit by the seas. About 6 days out now, and I'm getting seriously perturbed about this sort of weather. Not just now, but about the return that I'll have to face, sheeted hard on the wind. And so, examining the charts, I decided to change my destination, which had originally been Palmyra Island, to one slightly more upwind, Fanning Island. On a slightly better day, here's Moto finding his breakfast. He would do a daily patrol in the morning to retrieve any flying fish that had come aboard, although I must admit, these were rather few and far between, and not very large morsels when he did find them. I rather think he's not enjoying this sail quite as much as the previous one as a small kitten, when he managed to get into all kinds of trouble. Now, with weather improving, my spirits are lifting, and I decided to put on a ham show for the benefit of the camera. Do I never learn? It does worry me a bit, reviewing the picture now, that I noticed there's no safety harness in this picture either. No doubt I was supremely confident with good weather, the boat clipping along at about 5 knots under its best rig. However, even days like this have some pitfalls. Okay, so that's a lot of fun, but now try and get back, Charles. A camera on remote control has absolutely no mercy. I never got tired of watching those sunsets. And then, on December the 2nd, after a long night of navigation, which included shooting the stars, planets, the moon, anything which came into view through the misted mirror of the sextant, in the morning I rigged my makeshift steps up the mast. And came down. More excited than you can realize. Because there, peeping over the distant horizon, on the port bow, were the top branches of some coconut trees. Fanning Island, 30 degrees to port, and about 12 miles away, unfortunately quite well upwind. But I got the engine going and was soon closing with the island. It's a coral atoll surrounding a lagoon about 7 miles wide. It's absolutely beautiful. The only entrance is on the west side, a fairly narrow but deep pass. A couple of wrecked freighters characterize the downwind side of the island. The largest and most recent of which, I learned, occurred on a beautiful calm night when the captain, on his honeymoon, was celebrating along with the crew. Fortunately, I arrived at slack water, and having no better plan, followed a canoe through the pass. Already, I see some signs of civilization. A tugboat, I later learned, belonged to the University of Hawaii for occasional research. The water now turning a beautiful, milky, cloudy blue, but still turbulent with the tidal swirls as slack water finishes. I anchored close to the village, and the following morning, I was greeted by all the authority they could muster in the form of the policeman and the postmaster, doubling as a customs agent. They briefly reviewed my papers, especially the Playboy magazine, and headed for shore to announce my arrival. Not before formally inviting me, however, to a party to be held that very evening. So I hastily rowed ashore be greeted by some small boys wondering what on earth this was. Nostalgically, I look back at Sunshine, now quietly anchored, and flying for the first time the red ensign in acknowledgement of this British territory. An Australian, Bill Frew, runs the plantation, and this is his houseboy and tame frigate bird. At the party, I later saw this ritual costume dancing being performed by the children there. Each motion is depicting part of the story they are telling with enthusiastic accompaniment from the elder villagers on the tea chest behind them. When the weather got a little wilder on the lagoon, I was able to moor Sunshine at an old stone dock on the north side of the pass. Here, I was afforded some excellent peace and solitude with time to study the incredible wildlife of Fanning Island. One of my favorites was a magnificent frigate bird. In proportion to its weight, it has the largest wingspan in the world, as is easily demonstrated by its acrobatics in feeding and just general playing. In the lagoon, fish are incredibly abundant, especially at the entrance here to one of the little tidal streams, where one only has to dip in a net to pull out supper. Fanning has many palm species. Some, like these, with the downward sprouting roots, are termed walking palms, and one can easily imagine them strolling around in the dead of night to become rooted to a new spot at dawn. And this little creature is the hermit crab. Almost any apparently abandoned shell will be found to have life inside if it's inspected closely. Here's a sample of several different hermit crabs. Is there anybody home here, do you think? The giant manta ray can often be seen gliding eerily beneath the surface of the lagoon. As Christmas approaches, the happy Fanning Islanders declare a one-week holiday and set about enjoying their sports festival. The field is prepared, and all the public dignitaries invited. And they're off, with the backwards race perversely commencing first. Both young and old enjoy all the different events. There seems to be an incredibly childlike quality of happiness on this island. There's the concession, woven out of pandana leaves, playing rock music from a modern tape recorder. Such contrasts. Out in this 85-degree water, here was one form of losing which appeared to be most enjoyable. The object was obviously to remain out of the lagoon, but most of the spectators seemed to feel otherwise. All the girls tried at putting the shot. Although there were some commendable efforts, many had their minds more on dancing than competing, I think. There was serious sprinting, of course, First the boys, and then the girls. And I was on the finish line with my camera as beautiful Mariana won the adult final. And then came the egg and spoon. The spoon is clenched between the teeth and the egg is more like a little green apple. This really didn't look too tricky. And so following the men's heats and the women's final, I found myself lined up for the men's final. Joseph the Pasta is my cameraman. Now, in a race like this, I've always thought it advisable to hold around second place right until the last few yards. Boy, did I show them. Now for barrel racing. The Pacific Islanders equivalent of stock car racing, this is one of the most dangerous sports for the spectators as the participants are blindfolded. Here come the women. Talk about a demolition derby. One of these women, egged on by her friends telling her she was winning, rolled it right down into the lagoon. The serious sports followed, the copper cutting. The whole livelihood of these islanders depends on their ability in splitting, stripping, and collecting the coconut meat for storage. And here are the island's best. These islanders have been brought to Fanning in generations past purely for this harvesting purpose, and here they show their hereditary expertise at shelling the copra. Out of interest, I might note that it took me on my first attempt about 20 minutes to open one coconut. And we have a winner in record time, too. And then it was the ladies' turn, and as you can see, they too take a very active part in maintaining the family livelihood. And now we come to the regatta. These canoe races finished a dead heat after a mile and a half right across the pass to the lagoon. This was followed by sailing and the prayer-rigged canoes. And to get a better view, I took Sunshine out in the lagoon to shoot some of these pictures. My radius of action was a bit limited, as much of the lagoon is only about 18 inches deep. For those not so interested in the formal sports, there was always fishing. Some of the men would bring in average tuna catches. It would be the envy of many Canadian fishermen. I found out that the fish were caught with a long hand line from the outrigger canoes. The bait would be released at the chosen depth by jerking a slip knot tied around some flat lagoon stones. And the resulting feeding frenzy would hook a fish on the one baited barb. Five weeks went by all too soon, and when, after 2 days into tropical rain, I had determined that it looked as if a southeasterly wind could be relied on for a bit, I decided it was time to leave. Reluctantly, I set sail through the pass, the sounds of the village's hymn still ringing in my ears. Moto, my cat, and I had mutually agreed to a parting, so I was really alone this time. Through the small gap in the surf, I headed Sunshine out into the trades. And it's not long before the island recedes in the distance, and the familiar sounds are left behind as I head northeast to gain some precious easterly advantage from the temporary wind shift. Once again, we are all alone out in the ocean. But not quite alone, with the dolphins giving me a superb send-off. This was one of the best views I had throughout the entire voyage of dolphins frolicking around the boat. They came to me for about 20 minutes, and I was able to get some good pictures. Previously, they had been around the boat at night, perhaps attracted by the high squeal of my strobe light, and had consequently stayed well out of my photography. I was extremely lucky during the first 3 days that the wind held just south of east at about 15 knots, giving me my best possible upwind performance. And to be fair, I've got to tell you that the 3 days of excellent progress by Sunshine were matched by the worst seasickness ever of her skipper. With the helm lashed, I lay in my bunk, feeling like death only hours out of the lagoon. Here's a good view of the self-steering doing its work, and also one of the largest flying fish I found on deck. This made me think of Moto, of course, missing his breakfast. There were some squally days, calm nights, thundery nights. One note from my log says, lightning around the boat all night long. To gain precious miles east, I motored for some hours, but grew tired with the tedium of having to steer. And then the wind came back from the northeast, as expected, and I found that my altered course would just make the Hawaiian Islands. But not for long, as the breeze then lightens, veers around, and ends up right behind me. I can't believe my good fortune, and crack on sail with the weather staysail pulled out to add speed. Unfortunately, the weather change was not a good omen, as I should have realized. A system was tracking north of Hawaii, and within hours, the sea had got up, the wind veered right around to north, now blowing so hard that my best course would not fetch Hawaii, and tacking was impossible. I reefed her right down, cleared the deck, and prepared for the worst. Although it looks like pleasant sunny weather out there, it is rough, and for hours I lay braced on my bunk, confined in the humidly hot and airless cabin. A self-portrait from this time shows the strain of my concern as I alternately read and dreamt. Sometimes I dreamed of easier ways to travel with Sunshine. But always awoke back in that same windswept and desolate ocean. But the weather did start to ease, and I was able eventually to head Sunshine more north, and finally, by using up my last remaining gas, bring her within sight of Barber's Point, and eventually the familiar profile of Diamond Head. Gratefully, I looked anew at that civilization and those high-rises that I had so recently spurned. Engineless now, I tacked carefully into the marina channel and was soon moored safely, dwarfed by the other ocean travelers. Looking back out to sea, it's difficult to recall that over that horizon lies a simpler and maybe richer civilization that I and Sunshine have been privileged for a brief moment to discover. As a footnote, Sunshine ended her days at Expo 86 in Vancouver, a part of the Highway 86 sculpture. Moto, my cat, is presumably still sunning himself on the beaches of Fanning Island, surrounded by fresh fish and kittens. And I have gone on to higher things, more often navigating Canadian airliners across those empty oceans. Sunshine, almost all.